Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Esther Chesterman from the National Extension College. Thank you for joining our webinar this afternoon. The webinar will be available afterwards on our YouTube channel. I'll welcome Louise formally in a minute, but we'll just wait while people join the webinar. If you come in, please do say hi. It's always nice to hear a hello or say a hello to somebody in the comments. And we'll just wait a few minutes while people join. Hello everyone, if you're joining us now, I'm Esther Chesterman. I'm from the National Extension College. Louise will introduce herself in a minute. We're just letting people in to the webinar and then we'll start in a couple of minutes. If you do join, please say hi in the comment box. Always nice to hear from everyone. Makes Louise and I feel we're not talking to an empty room. I appreciate that you may not want to, so that's fine. The webinar is recorded and will be available on the NEC YouTube channel, and I'm sure the University of Law can share information where the link is afterwards as well. Okay, Louise, hi. I think we'll start if that's okay.
Yeah, that's so great.
I'm delighted to introduce Louise Musgrave, a student recruitment manager from the University of Law. I think this might be the second time we've met, but I think we've done a number of webinars now with the University of Law. So a good friend of National Extension College, and we do know this is an area of a sector that's of interest to a number of our students. So we're delighted to have you back. And I think the focus today is careers in law. So I'm going to hand over now to Louise, and I look forward to hearing a little bit more about careers in law and hearing from our students as well.
Thank you so much, Esther. I really appreciate that introduction. So welcome, everybody. Yes, my name is Louise Musgrave. I'm the student recruitment manager here at the University of Law. And before I get started, I wanted to find out what you may know about the University of Law. Perhaps you've come across us before, maybe you've even been out to one of our campuses. I actually work for the University of Law online campus. We do have an online facility, just as you study yourselves, which is great. And the wonderful thing about the University of Law is that over 90% of our LLB tutors are qualified lawyers, and they bring extensive practical experience to your studies. For the last 2 years, we've been the largest provider of the LLB in the country with over 1,000 enrolments. So, excuse me, just shows you the sort of size and students actually choosing us as a method to learn about the law. So our practical law degrees will help develop your skills in critical thinking, advocacy, negotiation, analysis, and strategy. So these are the core skills that are highly valued in the workplace, whatever you choose to do next. We do have, excuse me, I'm going to have a cough now. Excuse me. We do have campuses based across the UK in many cities, ranging from London to Birmingham, Manchester, Leeds. We're not just in one city. We also have a campus in Bristol as well. So we are sort of dotted around the UK, but obviously, as I mentioned before, I'm representing the online campus today. We are taught by experts, and we've trained more practicing lawyers than anyone else in the UK. We have over 80,000 students in our alumni network. Now, I put up here a little QR code, so feel free to click through to that QR code and you can actually get more information if you fill your details in there. We can notify you of events that are happening. We have a great event that's coming up called Criminal Investigation Day, where you can really learn about a real life heist crime. So do get yourself involved with that. We have competitions, so chances for you to, chances for you to win prizes. And also sometimes we also have experience where you can actually work for the University of Law. We have some work experience options available. So do log on and give us your details, and you can stay up to date about our degrees as well. So what are we going to do today? What is our agenda? Well, we're going to look at different areas of the law that you could potentially work in. We're going to look at what is the difference between a solicitor versus a barrister. And we're going to have an understanding of the legal profession and look at an activity as well that perhaps gives you a bit more of an insight into what lawyers actually do. And of course, at the end, you'll be able to ask any questions and feel free to pop information or questions or anything you're thinking in the chat box today. And Alice and Esther will kindly read that out for me, because I can't see it while I'm showing my slides. So first of all, this is a bit of an interactive area, and I'm going to ask you to guess the area of law. So you can see some pictures here in front of you. So could you tell me what that picture is of the person in a hoodie on the computer? What area of law do you think that may be? Has anyone got any ideas? Please pop your answers in the chat box. Okay, is anyone writing anything, Esther or Alice? Are you able to tell me?
Alice can tell you, I think, in the background. Yeah. I'm going to have a stab and guess. Is that okay?
Absolutely.
So I'd say it might be cybercrime.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is an image of a hacker, and it is representing crime. So crime has a huge spectrum from murder and theft to cybercrime, terrorism and white collar fraud, often not realized is crime is on the low end of earnings. So you don't necessarily earn lots of money if you work in that field, as near all the cases or near cases are funded by legal aid. So that's paid through the tax payers' money. In fact, it is not unlikely that sometimes a barrister will lose money on a case because their train fare was more than the case payment. So it's a very exciting area, though, with lots of prospects. We had a former ULaw student, Erin Cutliffe, OBE. She is a Crown prosecutor that specialises in anti-terrorism cases. She's an inspiration to a lot of people for having no sight and championing equality. So as insight and championing equality. And the thing about crime is that you need to be prepared sometimes to get calls at like 2 o'clock in the morning where you've got to go and represent your client at the police station. So, you know, it is interesting, and a lot of our past solicitors or who are now teaching would say it is a great area and interesting to get involved with. But do remember, it's not always necessarily the highest paid area. So what about this picture here of the person signing the contract? I mean, does anyone know who that is and what area of law that may represent?
Printhy guessed well last time. Printhy, thank you. And yeah, put criminal law for the last one.
Well done.
Printhy or anyone else know what this gentleman might be doing?
Or even do they know who the gentleman is? If anyone's a keen football player, there's your clue. Anyone got any ideas?
No football players.
Okay, well, that's actually an image of Harry Kane. Okay, and he's signing a contract, and contract law is an area that you will study on your LLB course. And we hear a lot of about contracts, but what do we actually know? A contract isn't just a piece of paper you sign. It's actually the agreement you make before that. If you moved into a flat or a house and there was no paper contract, you would still have one just by conversations you have had and the payments being made. The paper is just the T's and C's and helps with disputes. So lots of things are contracts. If you say to a friend, you give them £10 to walk your dog, this is a contract, no paperwork required. If you buy clothes from a shop, this is a contract. So another area of law that's interesting and you will study whilst taking your LLB. So what about the picture there of the couple arguing? What sort of area of law do you think this may represent? Two people having an argument, a disagreement. Any ideas? I'm putting anything in the chat box there. Any ideas? Is there anything coming forward, Esther or Alice?
Not at the moment. Okay,
don't worry. It can be quite tricky to know these areas. So this is looking at family law. Okay, this includes such things as divorce and childcare. People often think that divorce happens in court. This is nearly not always the case. You have to have lots of money for it to go to court, as court costs thousands. So that's important to remember. And it's trying to find some sort of mediation between couples. So most divorces actually use mediators. And this is someone impartial to give a fair split. But lawyers need to get involved. Maybe it's custody of children. Perhaps it's the sale of a property. This is an area of law that many students are interested in and will be something that you can study during your course or in your next courses once you finish the LLB. So what about that picture there of Parliament? What sort of area of law do you think that may cover? Obviously, we know that's where all the laws are set. Sort of area that may cover. Has anyone got any idea at all?
This might be a harder one, perhaps.
Yeah, it is a bit more difficult, I think.
Oh, there you go.
Somebody written something in there? Okay.
Prince Hassan has written constitutional law.
Okay, that could be, absolutely, well done. I mean, with the area we're going to talk about is public law, Parliament, but that's really good. So public law refers to the relationship between the branches of the state, which are government, Parliament and the courts. So, for example, judges, magistrates, etc. In the UK, public law is made up of constitutional, administrative law, exactly what you've said, tax law and criminal law. So why is public law important? Well, public law is important because of the possibility of unequal relationships. A relationship between the branches of state. Each branch must stay within its powers. For example, you can't discuss open cases in Parliament. So very well done there. What about this final picture of the car accident happening there? Does anyone have any idea what that may be representing? The area of law. Don't worry if you haven't heard of it, because it's an area of law that, again, you will look into.
Nothing coming through yet.
Okay, so that's looking at tort, personal injury. Yeah, so that's an image of a car crash. Tort law, T-O-R-T, it's spelt, is the law that you use when someone does something wrong, but it wasn't criminal, such as some car accidents. Maybe you've had a slip or a trip. If there's slander, trespassing, we often say, I'll sue them. So similar to divorce, we generally don't sue, as you only get what you deserve. For example, if you get food poisoning, you might get some medical or sort of loss of earnings. So maybe a couple of thousand. This wouldn't come near to the cost of court time and the legal costs. So tort law is an interesting area of law. So I've got another picture here. Has anyone got any idea what this picture represents, what area of law this may represent? Any idea? You've got some doctors there performing an operation.
Nothing coming through. Those who are on the call, feel free to type.
Type in, yeah, absolutely.
Yes, we have medical law, somebody has said.
Yeah, so it does. Looking at medical law or clinical negligence, obviously the NHS are under more pressure now more than ever, and mistakes unfortunately are made. So clinical negligence is a civil law case between patients and doctors when doctors are accused of making mistakes and malpractice. The reason this is an important area of law is because a mistake in the profession can be life-changing and also deadly. A lot of cases do come forward. This is often because medical science is not perfect and doctors need to make their best choices. Sometimes this isn't going to give the result wanted, but they did the best possible. So the limits of medical science are often blamed on attending doctors. However, in some cases, there is wrongdoing and it could actually be a criminal case. So there was a doctor, which I'm going to talk to you about now. In 2017, a surgeon admitted to marking his initials on the livers of two patients. So when another doctor performed an operation, they started to see that there was initials that had been burnt into people's organs. So Simon Bramhall actually pleaded guilty on two counts of assault after using argon gas to sign SB on a patient's organs. He was charged with assault by beating. This is less than the much more serious charges of ABH, actual bodily harm, such as obviously happens in fighting, and GBH, grievous bodily harm, in which you hurt someone in a life-altering, life-threatening way. So doctors make marks to show where to cut, but the doctor made the marks his initials. This doesn't supposedly have any negative health issue and obviously will heal. He was first suspended from his post as a consultant surgeon at Birmingham Queen Elizabeth Hospital in 2013 after the colleague spotted those SB initials on an organ during the follow-up surgery. So this was a criminal charge. However, the General Medical Council said it risks bringing the profession into disrepute and it must not be repeated. Whilst this failing in itself is not so serious as to require any restriction on Mr. Bramhall's resignation, it was necessary in response to issue the formal warning. However, when his suspension is up, any criminal convictions of a doctor are looked at, so we don't know if he will practice again. So following reports of Bramhall's suspension, a former patient said, and this is quite strange, even if he did put his initials on a transplanted liver, is it really that bad? I wouldn't have cared if he did it to me. The man saved my life, she said. So somebody actually supporting him in court, which is quite interesting. That's just how medical negligence can go a little bit too far. There's another area of law that you may find of interest. Does anyone know about the case of Naruto the monkey? Has anyone heard about that in the press? And what area of law this covers?
Never heard of that case. It's a great picture.
Yeah, a little cheeky monkey. Okay, so this is all about intellectual property law and copyright. So David Slater was a photographer. He set up his equipment in the jungle and was taking pictures of monkeys. This monkey came along and actually took a picture of himself. So you can see this wonderful smiling monkey. When David got back, he thought, oh, I'm going to make some money on that. I'm going to sell that photo because it's a fantastic photo. Wikipedia actually got hold of that photo and put it everywhere. So David said to Wikipedia, well, actually, you owe me money now because I own that photo. But it was found under copyright law, the person that presses the button is the person that owns that photo. So the monkey pressed the button. So therefore, he actually owns the photo. So the case went to court. And believe it or not, at the beginning, David wasn't entitled to any money because they said, well, in the case of the law, you never pressed the button. The camera, the monkey did when you disappeared for a short while. But later on, it was obviously found, it went to the Court of Appeal and was found actually, how could the monkey have even known what he was doing? So under copyright law, he did get some money and donated that money back to back to local sort of charities. So that's an interesting area of law, and you probably hear lots about copyright. For example, Ed Sheeran recently has been in the press where his music has sounded like somebody else's music. So then obviously he then is taken to court to try and prove he sang the song in court to prove that it was his own tune and it was unique to him. So it's all those sort of areas that you will look at while studying law. So now I'm going to ask you to have a little look here at a slide. It's a bit of a fun area of seeing what type of lawyer are you. Would you want to be a barrister or a solicitor? So I'm going to ask you some questions. What statements do you agree with? And you can either type them in the chat box or just sort of think them to yourselves, but I'm going to talk to you a bit about the different statements. So first of all, I want lots of contact with my clients who are businesses and the general public. So does that suit you more? Or perhaps I want to spend a lot of my time speaking in public and presenting an argument. I like the freedom of self-employment and can manage an inconsistent income. Is that you? Are you happy with that? You were self-employed? Or you want to know you've got a regular monthly salary? I would be comfortable familiarising myself with a case on short notice, often working weekends and evenings. I would like to work a case from start to finish, from initially taking the client's instructions, attending court if necessary, right through to the end of case. Or perhaps you feel, again, you know, maybe some you're agreeing with the blue, maybe some you're agreeing with the purple. So feel free again to type in to the chat box what you feel. Is it sort of the pinky purple colour or the blue? So I want to establish long-term relationships with my non-lawyer clients. I want to become an expert in a particular field of law and undertake specialist research. I would enjoy travelling around the country and working in different locations. On a day-to-day basis, I would rather spend most of my time in the same office. I want to work in a close-knit profession where I interact mainly with other lawyers, less with the public. And, a stability and job security is very important. So what do you feel after I've read those statements? Do you feel that you associate yourself with? It's a bit of fun, but blue represents a solicitor. So they are obviously found normally in law firms, in city centres or in town centres. They get their monthly salary. They know when they're being paid, compared to a barrister who has to go out and find their own work, their own cases. So I've got stories of some barristers who were on holiday, family holiday on the beach, and they get a call through to say, oh, this big case has come in, you're going to have to leave your family holiday and come and work on it. So, you know, you need to be prepared to do that if you want to be a barrister. So now we're going to have a little look at some solicitor facts here. So some stats, and that always sort of helps to find out a bit more about where lawyers are based. So you can see there's sort of legal hubs forming here. These can be found around the UK. So law firms are found in London, Manchester, Birmingham, etc. The reason there are so many lawyers in London is because of the headquarters of the largest firms. That's where you'll find your magic circle law firms, which are big law firms. This doesn't mean you have to be in London to be a lawyer, but when considering commercial corporate law, you might find that you spend at least some of your time working there. For things such as family, crime, immigration, employment, personal injury, these are sort of spread more around the country. So you can see here, we've got 202,374 individuals on the roll of the solicitors. And there may be a number of companies who have had their head offices in London too, but there may be more solicitors working in-house, that's in corporate companies, which we'll talk about on the next slide. So you can see here, most lawyers obviously work in private legal practice. This could be anything from a small firm on the high street that has one or two more solicitors. So you've probably seen those smaller law firms, maybe in your town centres where you live, to a huge city firm that has hundreds of employees, often around the world. The other 30% work either the in-house. This is when a business hires a few of its own lawyers, and they are on the payroll just like accountants and the marketing teams. They would generally only have in-house for areas they required lots of legal support with. For example, Tesco will most likely have an in-house solicitor. They probably deal with transactional and employment law. However, if they have had a real estate requirement, such as building a new supermarket, they would maybe go to a private practice firm. So public sector, these are the solicitors that work for the government services. So I'm not sure if anyone's heard of the CPS before, but that stands for Crown Prosecution Service. So these are people that prosecute UK criminals. So once somebody's been arrested, if there's enough evidence, it will go to the CPS to decide, will this be able to go to court? And the government has also has solicitors dealing with sort of immigration, attorney general's office, tax, etc. So I'm going to show you here a bit of a stat about diversity in law as well. It's often nice to look at the stats for diversity in law, especially solicitors. Barristers are also getting there, but solicitors are achieving great diversity. You can see here 51% women, 49% men in law firms. And a big thing in lots of law firms currently is to making sure the gender spread is the same all levels. So for this reason, firms have projects to help more women become partners. So very much looking to fast track as well, to make sure that you can get up the career ladder if that's something you are interested in. Okay, so we are now moving on to the next slide. And here we can see there are 10 times as many solicitors. Black, Asian and minority ethnic groups represent 17%. So we're looking here now at the legal stats of how many solicitors are there versus barristers. So you can see there are 16,435 barristers versus 202,374 solicitors. And that explains why it's quite difficult to become a barrister versus a solicitor. So now I'm going to show you a slide here, and we're going to be looking at what happens in witnesses and when they go to court. So why might someone be a witness? That's my question to you. Why do you think someone may be a witness? For what reason? Write that in the ask to be called to go to court.
They could have been at the they could have seen something happen, a criminal act, they wouldn't have been a victim though, would they? They would be. So Catherine said if they saw a crime happen.
Yeah, absolutely. If they saw a crime happen, and obviously what we're looking for in court is evidence. Eyewitnesses are the strongest piece of evidence in a case. So you'll find that that we need witness statements. Witnesses often try to fill in memory gaps. They're influenced by nature of a crime, and they're influenced by personal connection to the defendant. They may be influenced by other people's statement, maybe the media. So I showed you that picture. Do you remember what colour hair did that suspect have that I showed you? You got any idea? Do you remember? I'm not going to give you the answer yet. Is anyone writing in the answers?
Not yet. I think I know. I wonder if anybody else does. How good a witness were they?
How good a witness were you? You see, I went straight into that. And this is how it is with law. It could be doing one thing, then all of a sudden something happens and...
Nobody's wanting to say. I'm going to say mousy blonde.
Okay. And what colour was the carpet in the room? Do you remember?
Ooh. Anybody? Catherine, Printhy. Don't know the person who said Harry Kane. Anybody remember what colour the carpet was? I'm thinking a sort of blue.
Okay. And what colour jumper does the male have on? Do you remember?
I'm sure everybody else probably knows this and they're just being too nervous to say.
Don't be nervous. It doesn't matter if you get it wrong.
I saw a suit, but I can't remember a jumper at all. Was it grey? A grey jumper?
OK. Okay. And how many people are in the room? That one should be a little bit easier. Remember on the picture.
Everybody should be typing. Oh, unless this is a trick question. Somebody's in the background.
Oh, no. I thought three
people in the room.
Okay, there you go. So how good witness were
Catherine,
you?
Catherine said three, yay.
So even if, you maybe didn't write it down, but I'm sure you would have been thinking about it. So what colour hair did the suspect have? Well, blonde. What colour was the carpet in the room? You're right, well done. It was blue. And what colour jumper did the male have on? Well, he didn't have a jumper on. He had a suit. And how many people were in the room? So why did I take you through that? Well, I wanted to talk to you a bit about Turnbull in practice. And this is something that we use as lawyers, and also the police use it as well, to, if they are having to bring or to interview witnesses, because there needed to be a process and then really to make sure that witnesses were good witnesses. And if we're actually sort of looking at a particular crime or something had happened, we need to take into consideration these factors. So the lawyers put together something called advocate, which is basically mnemonic. So standing for A, the amount of time the witness observed the perpetrator for. So was it for a long time or a short time? D, the distance between the witness and the perpetrator. So how far away were they? Perhaps there was a fight that went on. You know, how far away did they really see what was happening? The level of visibility. Perhaps it was a stormy night and it was raining. So were you really sure what you saw is what you saw? Perhaps it was so much rain going on that what you said didn't really happen. Any obstructions in the line of sight? So, you know, very sadly today we're hearing the last few days about what's happening in Nottingham. And obviously people will be looking at that particular murder case and talking to witnesses. So any obstructions? Was there other cars in the way? Did you really see somebody running down the road? Was the perpetrator known to the witness? Any specific reasons to remember the event? Perhaps somebody was out for a birthday or a celebration. The time lapse since viewing the incident. So was it 5 weeks ago? Was it last night? You know, if it happened months ago, are they going to really remember the evidence correctly? And E, any errors in the witness statement? Because when you're going to court, this is where barristers could perhaps pick holes in or use it to actually support evidence. So these are the type of things that you will learn if you are studying the LLB with us. So just to give you a small snippet of some of the interesting information that you will look at. We also offer criminology degrees as well. So perhaps you may not be interested in the solicitor or barrister side, but you may be interested in working in the area of criminology. Now, we don't offer these courses online at the moment, but we do offer them in our campuses. So that's some area you may be thinking about doing. And what is criminology? Well, criminology turns on its head and challenges the laws that are currently in place. So these are some famous criminologists that deliver exciting talks. Do take a picture of them. Do listen to what they say online. You can find them on YouTube and get inspired. So Adam Foss is an assistant district attorney. He has a unique perspective on intervention with offenders' lives and making probation more transformative. You know, it's not just about putting criminals away and throwing the key. What can we do to try and make a difference to make sure that they don't reoffend? You've got Saha Koenig. She's an American journalist, public radio personality, former TV and radio producer, most famously known as the host and executive producer of the podcast Serial. So I don't know if you've listened to Serial before, but something to really tap into. And there's some interesting sort of murder and investigation happening there, and discussions over her podcast. And Akala is a British rapper, a journalist, an author, an activist and poet from Kentish Town, London. He's given lectures in universities all around the country on different areas of the curriculum, and he hopes to create social change by exposing the real history of the UK and having much more inclusive representative in mainstream media and pop culture. So these are all areas that people have got involved with, and also with a degree in criminology, you can go into other areas of work as well. So maybe a writer, a journalist, a social worker, perhaps you want to work on the probation service. So looking at ways to stop people offending, you may want to work on the scene of a crime. So actually get involved with investigation, community development workers, prison support workers as well. We get many criminologists going into prisons and working closely with them. You've probably seen some of the famous cases and famous criminologists on TV. And they will analyse maybe serial killers or repeat offenders to find out, you know, what makes them tick. So you may want to go into that area of research and become a lecturer in it. So lots of different areas you can go into, or the criminal justice advocate as well. So working in the courts. So, you know, really that gives you a bit of an overview there of criminology. And we're going to have a little look at some of the stats as well that's involved with criminologists. So we're going to discuss how criminologists might use stats and how some stats are used to present a certain message but might not always add up. So stats might not always be as clear as they seem. Some points, obviously, here you can see maybe we need better record keeping, an increase in police presence leads to more arrests, target to increase convictions. If we look at stats being, or comparing stats from 10 years ago, we might question how stats are collected back then. Are they still asking the same types of groups? Are we able to record better now due to technology and better resources? And if an area shows an increase in crime stats, such as pickpocket arrests, that area had a police force doubled in the last year, do we believe crime activity is increasing, or just the area is able to make more arrests now? So you can see here, is a graph showing the rates of homicides in the UK from 1971 to 2019. We can see peaks and troughs as expected. So we look at two of the more significant peaks. So in 2003, as a huge peak showing 944 unlawful deaths. This stat could be used to reflect high serious crime rate in the UK at that time. But what actually happened that year if we look closer to those stats? So actually in that year, Harold Shipman was a serial killer whose main victims were the elderly. As Shipman was a doctor, he was able to categorize his victims' deaths as naturally dying of old age. Shipman was killed from 1975 to 1998. He was sentenced in 2000. The inquiry continued until 2003, when 173 victims were reclassified as unlawful. So 2017 is a peak showing 675 unlawful deaths. Again, this stat could show an increase in crimes in the UK, which could be used to apply for policing, etc. Two things happened in 2017 that actually don't reflect the increase in crime. So the first incident actually relates back to 1989. That was the Hillsborough disaster, which was where mishandled evacuation of a stadium led to the tragic deaths of 89 people, as well as serious physical and mental damages to many more. This had been in the courts for a long time because decisions made during the evacuation were considered negligent by a lot of friends and families of the victims. This was finally agreed to in court, and the Hillsborough disaster was reclassified to manslaughter in 2017. So the incident was in 1989. The second highest event that year was a single high victim event. This year, what was the sort of Manchester Arena attack? You've probably heard about that in the press, in which 22 lost their lives. And this was recorded as 22 deaths, as it should be, but it was one single incident. So when you're looking at that graph, that graph, we really need to understand what is being recorded, as if the graph reflected incidents that lead to deaths, it would be a different picture. So stats are something interesting, and again, just to show you an area that you may study when looking at criminology. Now, the final course I want to talk about today is policing. So perhaps you're thinking about taking a degree in policing, and that's something that we offer. And there are three routes into the police force that we want to focus on pre-joining sort of degree, our BSc honours in professional policing. You can see here the pre-joining degree in professional policing. So that is basically learning the theory of policing. Students are encouraged to join the specials while learning, which enables you to put it into practice and is flexible around studying. So a non-policing degree, a conversion course called a degree holder entry programme, or an apprentice expected to last around 3 years, you apply directly to the force and attach to a university. That can obviously be very challenging. The pre-joining degree, the degree covers a lot of theory and legislation, as well as some practical aspects. Note you will still be required to pass the Police Search Recruit Assessment Centre and any vetting checks. The degree does not guarantee entry onto the force. So to become a detective, so maybe the police constable route, it's recommended to have practical experience being a constable. So 2 years minimum work experience as a police constable. Applicants with leadership experience can apply to the police for direct entry at inspector level. So that's 2 year training. So some extra information on specialisms. Once experienced as a constable, you may choose to join a task force. So here's some options for the Met Police. Forces obviously may vary. Perhaps you want to join the Marine Policing Unit, Territorial Support Group. Maybe the mounted branch, so the horseback policing. So you'll respond to both planned and spontaneous disorder across London. Probably see them when you're around London if you get a chance to go there. And their officers have a high profile ceremonial and military escort duties. Maybe you want to work in the dog support unit. So the general purpose of dogs are through seeking and tracking. They locate suspects, missing people, discarded evidence, property. You may get also involved with dogs and explosive dogs. So looking at bombs, victim recovery, working across the Met's 12 BCUs, the dogs can find scents such as human remains and blood to locate crime scenes of deceased people. Or you may want to get involved with counterterrorism, so responsibility for the policing of UK borders, being proactive and utilising a multi-agency approach to combat terrorism. So that is a little bit about the police force. So we've sort of looked at a life cycle of a crime in overview and detail here. So we can see here all the different areas that you could potentially work in. You can see here you may want to work as the solicitor, maybe on the defence or prosecuting, maybe as a duty solicitor, so that could be based in court. Maybe you want to get involved as a criminologist, so thinking about the sentencing, the bail hearings, the prison locating, and also you can also as a criminologist or as a lawyer as well get involved with the appeals. Oops, here you've got... Somebody ahead of me there, sorry. Here you've got the police as well. So perhaps you want to get involved with the police, the arrest and charging. So understanding all of those laws. And at the University of Law, we actually have an area where you can practice going into it. We've got an evidence room where there's crime scenes. So you can practice being a real police officer before you actually even have to go out and do it in real life. So how you arrest, how you charge. Perhaps with criminology, you want to look at crime prevention. With the lawyers, solicitors, you look at giving evidence in court, or maybe you want to work in the intelligence service, so more sort of with the police and understanding surveillance and all sort of different areas, some cyber crime, or perhaps you want support in criminal justice reform. So all of these different areas that you could get involved with. Again, with criminology, you could be looking at becoming a behavioural consultant, so understanding why criminals do what they do and how to stop them. Perhaps you want to look at witnesses and how witnesses are interviewed, so obviously, or perhaps you want to become an expert witness yourself. So some lawyers actually, we have people, let's say, for example, who've got medical degrees and then they want to go on and become an expert witness to be called into court. So they then go on to take further studies in law to become expert witnesses. And again, if you wanted to look at criminology, so reform and rehabilitation support, and also the criminal justice reform as well. So that's hopefully given you a bit of an overview of different areas that you could potentially go and work in the area of law, and how the University of Law supports that with our courses that you can investigate more online. But next steps for you, you need to aim for good grades, participate in as much extracurricular activities that you possibly can, take on positions of responsibility. So it's all about building your CV. And we were talking about this earlier. It's really important nowadays more than ever to try and build your work experience. So if you could start from now, you don't have to wait until later on. Perhaps you've got friends that work, friends of the family that work for law firms, perhaps you can get yourself down there for a couple of days just to see what it's like, and put that on your CV. Maybe you can go down to the courts, your local courts, and listen to some of the cases. So really try to build your CV from now. Gain commercial awareness. I talked to you today about some of the cases, those interesting cases. Perhaps you've never heard of them before, but go and read some quality media articles about the cases that are happening. Follow the cases, see what happens. Obviously, this horrendous thing that's happened in Nottingham, but from a crime point of view, it's good to sort of follow the case, see what happens, the arrest, and as the case goes to court, because that's going to be anything high profile that's in the media, you can start to learn how cases are dealt with, right from the arrest to the investigation to going to court and then the sentencing. So that's some advice on sort of your next steps. And we also have some podcasts that you can go and listen to on our ULaw website, our resources page on our website, which is www.law.ac.uk. We've got Law Pod UK, The Hearing, Lawyer to Lawyer, Law in Action, and obviously that serial that I was talking about earlier on. And as I mentioned earlier, do sign up, have a little log on to that QR code, put your details in so that we can contact you and invite you along to some more events like today, get you entered into some of our great competitions, and just stay up to date with us. So I'm going to leave that up there for now. I think I've reached the time limit. I think you said 45 to 50 minutes. So perhaps we can just have the last 5 minutes if there are any questions.
Thank you so much, Louise. That was a really packed lot of information that you passed on to us, but really interesting. So thank you. And thank you to the engagement from those who've joined the webinar. I'll ask a quick question while everybody thinks. Are there any new areas of law that are coming through that might be of interest, sort of climate law, climate change, or anything around AI, areas like that? Or do they fall under the categories of law that you've already covered?
Yeah, I mean, with the LLB, obviously the students will study the main areas of law. So they'll look at sort of crime, public law, they'll look at contract law, that sort of areas that we've talked about. And it's after they've completed their LLB. So they haven't got to worry at that stage, do I want to specialise in a particular area of law? Many students come to us thinking, oh, it's actually crime that I want to get involved with. When they get onto their postgraduate course, obviously you'll take your undergraduate degree and then you take your postgraduate qualification, it's at that point you can start to think about the area that you want to get involved with. So that's when you can pick certain modules in your LLP, so there's areas that do interest you. I mean, there are new, as you mentioned, AI tech is going to be a huge area moving forward. I don't know if people are aware, but the role of the paralegal, which would be the sort of secretarial almost role, or pulling everything together and finding notes and looking at how the law can apply to the particular cases. So some of that job role may be replaced with AI in the future. So it's important that students do have an understanding of that. So that's going to be a huge area for students to get involved with. Definitely areas such as environmental law is of interest to many students. Human rights as well, many students are really keen to get involved with that. They want to make a difference, make a change, and that's one way of doing that, especially if you're a human rights lawyer. You can change things that you're seeing in the press, perhaps that you're that really sort of touch the soul, things that may be happening in other countries, that you, as a lawyer, you can make that difference. So
lovely. Thank you. Well, we've had a few comments thanking us. Well, thanking you more, Louise, for that sort of webinar that really put forward a lot of different careers that students would be able to move into in the law sector.
So yeah, hopefully it's a little starter to get you thinking about, you know, I want to work in law, and it just gives you an idea of the jobs that are available and the courses that's also available for you to take in order to do that. Should I chat in the box, but the website, is that?
I think Alice will be able to do that for you. So if you can just read it out, Alice will put it in the chat. So it's
www.law.ac.uk.
Perfect, so she'll put that up. Thank you everybody for joining. Really good to have you and to have your engagement. Thank you again to Louise. I wish you all a lovely afternoon or evening or morning, wherever and whatever time you're listening. And you can watch this back on the NEC YouTube channel. Thank you so much, Louise.
Thank you. Have a good rest of your afternoon. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.